name is Ricardo Melendez Ortiz. I'm the head of ICTSD. It's a great pleasure for me to be here and to host this this panel. This is in the stream of the Trade and Development Symposium, which brings to you some of the work that we have been doing in the context of a project that we call the E15 Initiative, which is a joint undertaking of ICTSD and the World Economic Forum. We have been working now for a number of years on an experts-based inquiry to look into what are the policy options for the global trade and investment system with respect to a number of salient challenges that are posed to the system at this time. Part of that work relates to regulatory systems coherence. So how do we make sure that regulations do not, well, they do what they have to do, so they're not an impediment to exports or trade, that they do enable societies to do what they need to do, including to respond to those non-trade or non-economic agendas that, again, on which they have to act. So regulations refer to issues such as public health, environment, but also questions that are more and more on the agenda of today, like labor standards, as well as issues that are more specifically related to the products or the goods themselves, technical regulations to products, quality regulations, and so on. So what we're going to do today is really take a look at the what it's today a very complex landscape of in terms of the frameworks for trade and investment, and how, again, countries go about ensuring that there is coherence in their regulatory systems within that complex landscape. And in the context, again, of today, where we have emerging mega-regionals, regional trade agreements, bilateral trade agreements, other type of economic integration schemes, and the WTO, what can we expect going forward? And more importantly, what could we learn from the past, from the systems that we have in place, to try to make sure that as we move, again, into that future that looks more and more complex, there is no compromise, if you like, in the objectives, again, that countries have in their integration to the global economy, from the negative, particularly negative spillovers, that and externalities that using regulation in the domestic market may cause to others, both in the international markets as well as what as other domestic markets. So we have a panel that is made up of two participants in this E15 exercise, in specifically on the question of regulatory systems coherence. We have Bernard Hoffman, who's known to many of you. He's professor and director of the Robert Schuman Center for Advanced Studies at the European University Institute. The European University Institute, and specifically Bernard's outfit, participated in this expert group as the knowledge partner, and the team leader for the group was Petros Mavroidis, who worked closely with Bernard in ensuring the intellectual quality of the group. Then we would have Lorenza Jacquia, I think that's the right pronunciation, Lorenza?
Yeah.
And Lorenza is the secretary of the Working Party on Regulatory Cooperation and Standardization Policies at the UN Economic Commission for Europe, which is probably, I would think, the body with the most comprehensive and long experience in doing exactly this, first coming up with regulations and then looking at coherence of those regulations. And so they both would make their presentations and speak from their own perspectives and some of the work that has been done in the group, the policy options that we have generated that would be distributed to policymakers and on which we want to engage in with the policymaking, different instances of policymaking to try to see improvements in these systems. And then we would have as discussants Ho Lim. Ho Lim is currently the director in the WTO of the Trade and Environment Division, which is responsible for also the technical barriers to trade agreement. Is that correct? Yes. And again, Ho Lim has been for several years looking at these issues in various capacities within the WTO, as well as Alejandro Jara. Alejandro is now a senior counsel at King & Spalding, a law firm with an important trade practice, global trade practice, working out of Geneva. But previously, he was deputy director general at the WTO, and it's a well-known trade law expert, negotiator of many trade agreements that his country, Chile, has engaged with in the past at least 30 years. So with that, let me turn to the panel immediately, and so that we can start the panel and go immediately into the content. And I would start by giving the floor to Erner.
Thanks. So I think my job here is to take you through some of the kind of thinking of the group that worked on this whole issue of regulatory coherence, cooperation, and essentially the interface between trade agreements and regulation. So we all know the stylized facts, so the real motivation for the group is that traditional trade policies are becoming kind of less important. Certainly tariffs, average tariffs, have fallen quite dramatically. So if you think about what is creating trade frictions, what is segmenting markets today, it's increasingly of a regulatory nature. Now, of course, that's also nothing new. So to a large extent, this overlaps with the non-tariff measure type of agenda. So we have issues like product standards, which have been part of the trading system since, you know, decades. So we have an agreement on technical barriers to trade in the WTO. We have the SPS agreement in the WTO. And we have various provisions that kind of relate to regulation very directly. So for example, in the GATS, the General Agreement on Trade and Services, there's a specific article that deals with domestic regulation, largely because if you think about what constrains trade and services, quite frequently it's going to be very much overlapping with the regulatory regime that prevails in a particular market, which is going to be different from the regime that might be prevailing in the exporters market. So you get into issues of recognition, of certification, you have licensing schemes, and so forth. So in a sense, this regulatory agenda is both very broad, it spans many sectors, and part of it is already embedded in the WTO, but there's a general sense, I think, certainly among the business community, that we need to do more to actually deal with the costs that are associated with differences in regulation, as well as trying to deal with specific instances of regulatory policies which are explicitly discriminatory, but which might not be captured by the WTO today. And to a large extent, at least in terms of the rhetoric, the motivations for initiatives like the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership are very much focused on trying to actually deal with differences in regulatory policies and regimes across the Atlantic. So in terms of what the EU does in a particular area relative to what the US does. I think the big question, which we certainly don't have an answer to, we didn't come anywhere close to an answer to in this particular group, is how do you design trade agreements to actually deal with this issue? Can trade agreements help? And I think this is a question which certainly hasn't been asked enough by the trade community. I think the regulatory community also hasn't really thought about this a whole lot. So regulators do whatever they're supposed to do in terms of their legal mandate. They design systems to try and achieve those mandates. They don't really think about trade necessarily. They don't think about the trade effects of what they do, partly because nobody's told them that is something they should do. right? So we have, in a sense, parallel worlds. And I think it's really the challenge for the trade community in particular is to come up with a compelling rationale for why a lot of these regulatory issues should be addressed in trade agreements. So, in terms of the status quo, so what the synthesis paper does, it focuses primarily, if pretty much exclusively, on the WTO. And I think one reason for that is to try and narrow down the focus. But I think it's important to also think beyond what is in the WTO as to what we might do in the future. So what we have in the WTO is primarily disciplines that relate to standards for products, right? That's TBT, SPS. In terms of what we have on services, where in fact most of the regulation is actually, there's a lot of regulation obviously of service sectors, they're very weak disciplines. So that's one kind of big challenge, I think, for the WTO. But what is also, I guess, under-recognized by people, I guess, in general, is that what we have in the WTO in terms of dealing with issues relating to product standards actually works pretty well, right? So we have requirements for notifications. There are specific disciplines that actually bite in terms of non-discrimination, in terms of having to justify standards that go beyond what is required, that to go beyond restricting trade, beyond what is required to actually achieve the objective. There's a strong call for international standardization, adopting international standards. So if countries actually adopt international standards in a particular area, then the presumption is that, that even if that has a negative trade effect, that is not something that is contestable because the international community has determined, decided that this is actually a good way of regulating that particular product. So there's a background paper that was done for the group written by Eric Wegström, who is actually working, who is in the WTO secretariat dealing with these issues, which I would very much recommend to those of you who are interested in this topic because it goes very, in some detail, but not a whole lot, so it's not gonna take you a lot of time to read, but just explaining how this process actually works in the WTO. And the takeaway from that is pretty good. Right, and in fact, there's been some innovation in the functioning of these committees, both the SPS, TBT committees, which actually allow countries to put forward concerns they have with respect to regulations, product regulations that are being considered or that have been put in place by other countries. So this is something called specific trade concerns, and I think one of the things that could usefully be done in thinking about how we could expand the role of the WTO in at least tabling matters relating to regulation and in terms of what they might do in terms of adversely affecting trade, this specific trade concerns kind of concept is something that could potentially be broadened to other areas. So in terms of policy recommendations in the paper, I think there was a consensus that we need a lot more transparency in this area. And I think the notification process for TBT and SPS seems to be working quite well. But clearly, there's a whole range of other regulatory areas where there isn't anything being notified to the WTO. So in a sense, it's a bit of a black box, what is out there. So that is one a strong recommendation that comes out of the paper. There's also a call for greater use of international standards when we have such standards, also in other areas, right? So this goes beyond TBT, SPS. And a recommendation that maybe one of the things that could usefully be done in the WTO context is to try and encourage members to actually use tools like regulatory impact assessments, which have been developed in other contexts, to actually go through a process of thinking about what are the trade effects of new regulations that are being considered. Right, and that is something which is embedded in a number of the more recent preferential trade agreements, so in a sense, the idea is take some of those provisions and multilateralize them, try and put them into the WTO. One of the issues relating to regulatory cooperation, which constrains regulatory cooperation, is that regulators have a very clear mandate to achieve a particular objective. And you cannot tell a regulator that therefore you should now automatically accept what another country is doing. So that process of recognition, that process of assessing whether or not countries are relatively equivalent in terms of what they do, requires a lot of interaction, exchange, communication, ultimately all
boiling down to different regulators need to trust each other in terms of what they're doing before they're willing to accept the regime that prevails in another country so that goods and services can come into their markets. So that inherently constrains the scope for regulatory cooperation. It's clearly not something you can do in one fell swoop for 163 countries. It really calls for building this up gradually. So that suggests a clear case for, in certain areas of regulatory cooperation, to say, well, we do that on a plurilateral basis. So the paper calls for greater considerations being given to plurilateral mechanisms of cooperation and regulation, but very clearly on a non-discriminatory, open, transparent basis, right? So, and there's a clear link here to be made, which is made in the paper, that insofar as we have a particular area where regulators see it in their interest to cooperate, but that is conditional on achieving a certain level of efficacy in terms of the enforcement of that regulation, is to link that to capacity building, right? So there's a really an obvious link here to be made to the Aid for Trade agenda. So insofar as we have identified good practices, good regulatory practices in a particular area that a number of countries agree we're all going to pursue, if other countries also want to do that but are not yet in a position to implement it, you know, there's obviously a link here to help them improve the capacity to do so, and we have the Aid for Trade mechanism already there, which could be used. So, the paper doesn't really engage very much with this question of what's the rationale for doing this in a trade agreement. Clearly, one reason regulation is coming to the trade agreements is because these differences in regulation are costly for firms, right? They have to go through duplicative procedures. So what could a trade agreement do? I think one really clear area, and this is emphasized in the paper, is information transparency. So I've already mentioned that. I think the other thing a trade agreement can do in terms of promoting regulatory cooperation is to give the regulators a clear mandate to talk to each other and to look at the trade effects, which they might not otherwise do. So that's one dimension. I think the other dimension that a trade agreement can bring, or doing more of this in a WTO context, but also in a preferential trade agreement context, is to raise the political visibility of these issues, right? Because trade agreements, you know, they might have a ministerial conference once a year, but there's going to be mechanisms where economic policymakers are going to be talking to each other, which they wouldn't do kind of naturally in terms of the regulatory process, right? So it can give a political nudge, it can help provide a focal point for actually thinking about and pursuing and implementing agreements to try and reduce the costs of differences in regulations. So that's the end of my time?
Yeah, but
I think that is the end of my time. Good. So just a few final points. I think this question of how can trade agreements be designed to actually foster regulatory cooperation is, I think, still very much an open one. I think there's a lot more work and thinking that needs to be done. And from my perspective, also having observed the TTIP negotiations between the US and the EU on this, I think you really need to start from the perspective of the regulator. And the trouble, I think, regulators, it's a bit the same story we had with competition policy, when competition policy was being discussed in the WTO. The great danger is that the regulators are going to see the trade people as saying, okay, we only care about market access. And I think what we need to do is to say we have regulation for a reason. So to sell the regulators on getting involved more in trade agreements is to say, well, this is actually going to help you do your job better. Right? And there are various kind of relatively obvious ways in which you can make that argument, because if regulatory cooperation actually can be made to work, that releases resources for the regulators, right? If they can trust a regulator in another country for doing a good job, they don't have to duplicate and basically devote scarce resources to doing that. They can devote those resources to something else. So in a sense, you can design these, you really have to think about designing the trade agreements like you actually can make a credible case that this is all about doing regulation better as opposed to trying to get countries to change their regulations because simply driven by an objective of reducing costs. So I think that's really the key message that I would take from the discussions we had in the E15 group. The other key message is, of course, one that relates to bringing what is going on in the preferential trade agreement context back to the WTO. So there is a big issue of multilateralization. And I think there it's partly what the paper advocates is a greater focus on international standards. So that's one way of ensuring that we are moving towards a more multilateral approach. The other is what I already mentioned, is really this bottoms-up approach where we have open plurilateral agreements tied to technical assistance, capacity building, that over time you can expand what is being done, not just in trade agreements, and I think I should mention this as well, but also in terms of what countries are doing completely outside of trade agreements in terms of regulatory cooperation. Right? So in the US-Canada context, for example, there is something called a Regulatory Cooperation Commission or Council, which really acts as a focal point for regulators from both countries to sit together and to see where they can actually cooperate to reduce enforcement costs to enhance the achievement of regulatory objectives. So again, that is something where from a multilateralization point of view, you want to see, well, can we think about expanding those types of systems? And again, there, it's really an open question. Does it make sense to do that in a trade agreement or not? All right, so I'll leave you with to mull over that question. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Bernard. That's it's very good because it's not only very clear, but it sort of poses exactly the questions that we have to go through on this issue. So let me turn now immediately to Lorenza, and Lorenza then to talk to us from her perspective. Lorenza.
Thank you, Ricardo, and thank you for having me here. I'm going to try to answer some of the questions that Bernard has very clearly posed to us, and particularly how it is that regulatory cooperation can help with the challenges that are before us. Before I turn to that, let me say a few words about the working party that I am the secretary to, the Working Party on Regulatory Cooperation and Standardization Policies. UNECWP6, which is an intergovernmental body, but also open to participation from the industry, from regional and international organization to standard setting bodies, and really to everyone from all UN member states. And it's been in existence for now more than 45 years with a very broad mandate ranging from standards to technical regulations to accreditation, conformity assessment, market surveillance, risk management, and a number of flanking issues, with activities that range from developing and sharing best practice to capacity building to drawing up recommendations and sectoral initiatives in sectors where members feel a need to go further and engage in regulatory cooperation. This is not the right version of the presentation. Oops. Well, before I get into this, I'd like to say a few more words about the challenges that are before us, and in particular about the increased proliferation of substandard and counterfeit goods on international markets. That really is the challenge that is before consumers and before industry internationally. And it is staggering that at the same time as the businesses internationally are spending an increased amount of their budget on testing their products so that they are conforming to the regulations in place on the markets to which they are exporting, at the same time, we have on the markets increased rates of non-conformity, and we see consumers exposed to risks from the use of products that are not in compliance with the rules that governments have set. And at the same time, it's not only a problem that relates to consumers, but it's also a problem that really is affecting the industry at many levels, because these products are not just consumer products, but are really also equipment that is used in factories, is used in plants, and is sometimes not only unsafe but also counterfeit. And we use and we see a proliferation of these threats internationally. So how do we deal with the issue of having an increased budget spent on testing and conformity assessment with the reality of having non-conforming products on the markets? And it's the same? Yes, okay. Nonetheless, the solution that I explore in the paper that I have authored with Chris Sarabius in the context of the regulatory cooperation initiative within the E15 is that we explore the increasing ledger of ambition among countries in going forward and in engaging in regulatory cooperation internationally. And what we argue with Christer in our paper is that regulatory cooperation, first of all, starts at home. And there cannot be regulatory cooperation unless countries have first done their homework, so that their regulatory practice at home is established on a sound foundation of good regulatory practice. And this regulatory practice really is embedded in the principles of the WTO-TBT agreement and in the principles of the WTO-SPS agreements. And this is clearly based on practices relating to what Bernard was extensively referring to in terms of reference to international standards and in terms of having increased proportionality of regulations between regulations and the risks that they address. And that is an important part of the mandate of the Working Party as well. So the paper explores the different options that are before the regulatory and the regulatory authorities and the negotiators in terms of what they have at their disposal for engaging in regulatory cooperation internationally once they have established these forms of good regulatory practice at home and they want to engage further internationally in having deeper forms of regulatory integration. And what we propose in practice is a model that was enshrined in one of the recommendations that the Working Party adopted recently in 2015, and it is the recommendation L, which is an international model and gives countries practical tools for going forward and engaging in regulatory cooperation internationally. And the international model refers not just to the need for common regulatory, common technical regulations, but also engaging them further in terms of what it means to have the products really accepted on the ground and really accepted on the markets. So not just defining technical regulations that are common, but also defining mechanisms for common conformity assessment procedures and acceptance of conformity assessment results. So the model includes not just the pre-market dimension in terms of having the products recognized on the market, but also the post-market dimension in terms of having common procedures for checking out products which are non-conformant, and checking out products which are dangerous for consumers and for the industry. In practice, the recommendation L has been used, and there have been four sectors in which the recommendation was used in practice with four initiatives in four different sectors: the equipment used in environments with an explosive atmosphere, earth-moving equipment, and pipeline safety and telecommunication equipment. And without going into much detail about that, I'd like to say that the lessons we've learned from these initiatives going forward is that there are a number of advantages in working with conformity, in working and engaging in regulatory cooperation. And these are they can be grouped into two broad areas. On the one side, really, the importance is how these make a difference for the industry. So the industry, instead of having to redo the conformity assessment and tests at each market to which they export, clearly will have an advantage from having their results recognized internationally. And this is what we see every day. But it is worth repeating that it's not enough to have common technical regulations. You really need to go forward in establishing trust in the results of each other's conformity assessment activities and processes. But there is another dimension that I think is worth stressing, and it is the advantages that regulatory cooperation also delivers in the post-market dimension. When we think of the post-market dimension and the risks of that is posed, as I was saying in the opening remarks, really, the risks for consumers and the risks for the industry in terms of having non-conforming and dangerous products in the industry and on the market, it can be thought of as having two dimensions. On the one side, a technical dimension, so the risks of the equipment or product in its essence, and the second dimension being the probability of compliance by the industry. And so clearly going towards an increased level of risk for the authorities and an increased need for authority intervention in the post-market phase of a product, so that there is an increased need for intervention in terms of inspections and in terms of controls by the authorities. And how can regulatory cooperation help in this area? And I think that that's very important, because when we align conformity assessment practices internationally, we have increased probability of compliance, which is really delivering to the regulator, because we are using methodologies that are involving a wider range of expertise. They're involving partners that have been recognized internationally as best practice. And this really improves the quality of the accreditation of the assessment agencies. And it also has an ongoing monitoring of the assessment and has a wider pool of agencies using these assessments so that they can be reliably reported and that market surveillance authorities can really be taking actions on these issues. It is important, as I was saying in the opening, that these practices are based on a common assessment of the risks of the products. And we've been doing extensive work on this since 2009 in the WP6 by also developing an approach that is holistic and calls to a way of managing risks that products pose on the to consumers, that products pose to the wider public, and that needs to be treated holistically, starting from the definition of regulatory objectives through the drawing up of technical regulations and through the post-market phase of conformity assessment and really actions taken to take dangerous and non-conforming product from the market. So with this, I'd like to conclude, just pointing to further actions that and further areas where we could think of regulatory coherence as being important, and in particular, standards-based regulatory cooperation, the role of standards and quality infrastructure in going forward with the Sustainable Development Goals and the 2030 Agenda, and finally, managing risks as a foundation for regulatory cooperation. I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lorenza. I'll turn immediately to Paul Lim and ask him to discuss what he has heard, but also to inform us from the perspective of the WTO.
Thanks very much, Ricardo, and thanks for the invitation. I think, you know, if I can, to try to go back to some of the remarks that Bernard had already gave us, and also pick up some from Lorenza. And if one looks at the paper from the E15, you know, they set out quite usefully, I think, two big sets of recommendations, one which is on the institutional and the other on the substantive. And in plain language, perhaps, on the institutional, what are we talking about? Essentially, it's a question about if we are going to deal with regulatory cooperation, regulatory coherence, who should be involved in that, and in what fora should that interaction take place? And of course, the second question, what would they be cooperating on? What is the substance of that particular cooperation? In general, I mean, this is a very general comment perhaps, but in general you find that, you know, the best approach is really to allow the substance to dictate the form. In what are we actually going to be cooperating about? And once we know that with a bit greater clarity, what form should that take? In trade jargon, that brings us to this concept of variable geometry. Essentially, you pick and choose between different instruments, different templates, different types of agreements, if you like. Now, if we understand that, you know, substance should dictate form, therefore, I would say variable geometry does make sense. Okay. Now, is this a new thing? Not really, because even if you look at the WTO, there's a lot of debate about what variable geometry means for WTO, but nevertheless, if you look at the agreements today, it is already there. I mean, we do have different types of commitments taken by members, we have more formally different types of agreements, and then within the agreements themselves, you do have, again, a differentiation in terms of what commitments are there. And I'll come back a little bit on this point. So I think the E15 recommendation here that, you know, one would have to think about a differentiated set of instruments when we think about regulatory cooperation and regulatory coherence certainly makes sense. But that being said, how do we do it in the WTO if we do see a role for it within a trade agreement? And there, it's not that easy always. Unless you choose the option that I think Bernard had already mentioned of going down what we call, again, open plurilaterals. Maybe it might be worth explaining this point a little bit more. Of course, you know, there are plurilateral agreements already in the WTO. The ones that probably most of you would know well might be the government procurement agreement. But that is a closed plurilateral. Only the parties to that agreement enjoy the benefits to it. But there are also other types of plurilaterals, and the most recently concluded one, at least expansion of it, the information technology agreement, which is a more of a critical mass agreement, whereby even if you're not a party to it, you benefit from that agreement. So we would be seeing that it would be easier, clearly, to go down the path of open plurilaterals, because to create a closed plurilateral in the WTO, you will need a consensus decision by members, and getting that decision could certainly be very challenging. But there's a critical difference between the critical mass plurilateral agreements that we've seen today, like the ITA and the Emerging Environmental Goods Agreement. Those agreements deal only with one thing, which is tariffs, the reduction of tariffs. Here, when we talk about regulatory cooperation, from what I understand of the concept, we're really looking into the world of non-tariff measures, which has already been outlined both by Ricardo and Bernard and Lorenza. So you're looking at very different types of measures, okay? Clearly, if you're dealing with regulation, you cannot eliminate them, you cannot make it zero. Unlike in a tariff negotiation, that would be the aim. And therefore, another question arises, is free riding so important when we come to deal with regulatory cooperation or regulatory coherence? In a market access plurilateral, it seems to be very fundamental. Those participants typically would not allow benefits to be enjoyed by all unless they achieve something like 90% of world trade. I was pondering about this question, you know, in coming to this panel. When we think about regulatory cooperation, on the other hand, it's a very different world. I mean, you're talking here about regulatory mechanisms, regulations, standards, good regulatory practices, things that Lorenza has already outlined to us. And if these are the areas that we're engaging in, does the notion of preferences actually matter? I mean, or free riding for that case. I mean, would a regulator actually implement good regulatory practices for some members and not for others? It would seem to me a much more horizontal thing, that if you do engage in good regulatory practices, you would do it for all. So therefore, the logic again builds upon the notion of going towards what Bernard has said, an open plurilateral. You know, people should not, in other words, be so threatened by the notion that they can go forward, they can find ways to regulatory cooperation, and therefore build on that. Are there already existing examples of it? I mean, I will come back a bit later to TBT, which, you know, Bernard mentioned, my colleague Eric Wickstrom, who is the secretary to that committee, is actually part of the E15 initiative, and he's given quite a lot of input to the TBT experience. Let me try to bring in a slightly different experience, which is from the services world. Bernard said that, you know, services does not have a parallel to TBT. That's true. I mean, there is no sort of TBT equivalent in the services agreement, the GATS. But if we think about regulatory cooperation in a more expanded way, there are things that are already there in services that do bring regulators together. And the most prominent one is the telecoms reference paper. The telecoms reference paper in services, which, for those who are not familiar with this, is a set of regulatory principles for which telecom regulators are meant to abide by. I think it's an interesting example because it's also a form of open plurilateral. Because what happens is that you have a template. In that template, you have a set of regulatory principles. They become binding should the member insert it into its schedule. And once it does so, it is open to, well, to all WTO members to enjoy the benefits of. Mm-hmm. So it's a form of cooperation. It's different from TBT in the sense that it doesn't have a clause on being not more burdensome than necessary. But it's an example if we go down the way of variable geometry. The other aspects in the paper, which deals more perhaps towards substantive aspects of like what should there be in a type of regulatory cooperation agreement. A lot of emphasis is of course put on transparency, and related to transparency, the issue of business participation. Now, I think it's clear that, you know, and we see it already in the TBT committee, that trade representatives need specialized knowledge when they engage on specific trade concerns, for instance. And that participation is important. But here I will pick up again what Lorenza has said. A key aspect that we have seen is that the most successful members in engaging in the committee tend to be those who have built up that participation at home. So a lot of the coordination that allows them to engage effectively in the international forum starts basically domestically. And so that's a big challenge, I think, for some countries. I mean, it's a challenge for my own country, Malaysia, where I come from, but I'm sure it's a challenge also for many other developing countries. How do you bring about the internal domestic coordination that would allow effective participation at the international level? Mm. And here, just to say that, you know, when we think about business participation, we should also be mindful that we should be taking into consideration a wide range of business interests, meaning both large, small, and perhaps even micro. And that's not one single business voice that we are listening to. And equally, since it's about trade and regulation, there's a need to consider wider civil society interests. And it cannot only be driven by a pure business agenda. You might find that weird from someone who's coming from the trade forum, but the reality is that, you know, you do need a wider representation. On transparency, Well, you know, one cannot disagree with that. I mean, you know, everyone wants more transparency, and certainly that's good. One thing I could say is that apart from having more things notified to the committee, including covering things that are on measures based on international standards, the implementation side is also important. How do we get these notifications out more efficiently to those who are directly concerned? And one recommendation we've had in the committee is to create an alert system which would allow immediate response to businesses or to anyone who is interested in receiving this information. So that's one very practical area of work that we are engaging in. The paper also talks a lot about you know, what are essentially regulatory impact assessments, you know, such as the use of ex post assessment after the regulation has already been put in place, and monitoring to see has the regulation actually achieved its stated objective, etc. Now, some of this mirrors ongoing discussions in the TBT committee, especially on the establishment of guidelines and good regulatory practices. I mean, in these guidelines, one of the recommendations is essentially to have this, to have monitoring of regulation to check whether it's working and serving its original purpose in an effective, cost-effective way. But of course, we also realize that it's a big challenge. Okay, I mean, it's a good recommendation, I believe, but again, implementing it has challenges because it calls for capacity. So I think there's a need to think about this in a pretty broad framework as to how can you actually improve institutional capacity for regulatory impact assessment. Bernard has mentioned aid for trade. There might be other avenues to think about, but essentially this is a very big agenda on improving that capacity to deal with regulation. And a very small anecdote, I know I was at a dinner last evening with some entrepreneurs who was hosted by the Malaysian minister, and these entrepreneurs were trying to sell into the Malaysian market. And they basically said, our problems are we can't meet SPS, we can't meet quality. And again, these are issues of capacity. It comes back down to what's happening here locally with the quality infrastructure. I guess I'm running out of time. So I had a few more thoughts about the TBT experience, but let me leave that for questions and discussions. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Holim. And yeah, it's a pity we are pressed by time because it is fascinating what you have gone through. And I think we need to hear about also the experience of the WTO. So far, but let's come back to that in the questions and answers. I just want to make sure that we do have time for that. I recognize in the public a few people that are quite knowledgeable about these issues as well, and I'd like to bring them in. Alejandro.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the invitation. Rather surprising here because I'm sure that I'm going to be lowering the intellectual standards of this panel. So I'll try to be very brief in order not to cause too much damage. One, two, three points is, well, I think only at the beginning of a new wave of regulatory activity. There's more to come, and there's more tension, litigation, and so on around the corner, if already we have seen some of it. So there's much to be done in order to avoid bad outcomes, and part of it is international cooperation. I see it as essential. So my first point, as my former boss, Pascal Lamy, with his French accent, would say, societies are moving from systems to protect the producer to protect the consumer. And this has big implications in terms of the political economy. Because these protection of the consumer means health, means environment, means human rights, and other areas. And behind this, there are values. Political, social, moral, ethical values, and what he calls the collective preferences. And at the same time, we have a different layers of regimes of international cooperation in order to avoid suboptimal outcomes in this respect. Some of them have been mentioned, the WTO and different manifestations, codex, preferential trade agreements and so on, and what the UNEC has done and so on, Codex and others, fantastic, but certainly, to my mind, not enough. So what do we have? We have, to use WTO jargon, we have, if you will, requirements that you should achieve in terms of real regulations, the less trade restrictive measures or standards, or that you should base the protection of your plants or animals, et cetera, on scientific evidence. So that's one. And that, I would say, is opposed to the pursuit of public policies, as I stated, that designed to protect health, environment, and so on. And many of these, the people who deal with these public policies, they feel entitled that they can do whatever they want to do or they should do in order to achieve their public policies to protect health, for example. So this comes, for example, from the WHO to the regional bodies and to the domestic, to the national public health offices, and then we run into trouble because they have achieved outcomes which do not consider what is the trade impact of that, or maybe there have been more efficient alternatives. So we have, I think, a situation where regulators are institutionally, politically weak, for the most part. They know their stuff, they know what they have to do, they are very efficient, they're very good, but they can fall prey to either captured by sectoral protectionist interests sometimes, or at other times, and increasingly so, I think, to bad politics. That leads to regulatory failures, I would say. We have had some manifestations of those and some, you know, quite well-known cases which have been litigated in the WTO. Seals is one, more recently. GMOs, hormones, the cool labeling in the United States, and not too long ago, months ago, the approval in Chile, my home country, of the most extreme food labeling regulation, which doesn't make sense. I think it's misleading and it's stupid, and I can be quoted on that, please. So this is because they fall in prey mainly to bad politics, the people who are almost in a competition to see who protects the most. And they don't care about other alternatives, about the trade impacts, et cetera. So what I think that has to be done, and I think the paper and what has been stated and the experience, for example, of UNEC and so on, help in terms of moving the reaction to this in terms of devising forms of international cooperation that will help governments to protect governments from themselves, if you will, to help the regulators resist when the pressure comes from bad politics, from protectionists, to say, no, we cannot do this because I have to make sure that whatever I do is based on science. How much science do we need? We have to define that. We have to define the methodologies across nations. We have to make regulators more accountable. We need more private sector involvement. We need better processes in this respect. It will take more and more time to get it perfect, and maybe it will never be perfect, but at least I see that this is moving in the right direction, but we have to move quickly, because my fear is that regulatory tsunami is only beginning. For example, ideas such as being forced to review the impact of your regulations after a certain number of years, and to use methodologies which will, in the minds of all, will be acceptable, in terms that they have gone through a process of a reasoning and to achieve a certain conclusions whether a regulation, that particular regulation, is the most effective or not, and whether it should be changed in one sense or another. So I think the debate is open, and I'm happy to become aware of all these concerns and how this the E15 initiative has helped develop ideas and a reflection of this, which can greatly improve the international cooperation in this matter. Thank you.
Thank you, Alejandro. That's it's really very impressive what we just have gone through. I think with the four presentations, it's an incredibly comprehensive, really very complementary set of perspectives. It gives you a crash course on what are really the issues here in a very good way. So thank you all very much for that. We have raised very fundamental questions in the panel. What is the role of trade agreements in all this? Jumping to Alejandro, his point, how do we move from regulatory, not from protecting the producer to protecting the consumer, and where does legitimacy comes in, and how is it affected or not by the systems in a way? Through the question of good practice in what I think very interestingly Lorenza and the UNECE called transboundary regulatory cooperation. What? The question of how the detail is, that the devil is in the detail, is in the conformity assessment, and how does it's done, and so on. And most importantly, the post-market phase, and who takes care of that. It's a very interesting point as well. And obviously, the discussion on the WTO and Holim has brought to the table a whole series of very interesting questions. Just rescuing one of them is this issue, which is was dealt with by the group on the, on plurilateral arrangements and variable geometry, whether critical mass is or not necessary for cooperation through plurilaterals under the WTO. So plurilaterals within the WTO that that deal with regulatory issues. We have in the WTO, as you said, that example of financial services, which is the only instance where we have plurilateralism, open plurilateralism on regulatory issues. Outside, we have many instances of this. Outside of the WTO, I mean through the PTAs. And so that was also part of the discussion, and Bernard has also referred to that. What is the role of the WTO in that respect? Should there be a more structured reflection on this question of in the WTO of the rather than discouraging, promoting this plurilateral cooperation in the right way, and perhaps build from the PTAs or bring from the PTAs. One of the things, for instance, that we have seen recently is when in the TPP, there was agreement on subsidies in fisheries. One of those issues that was elusive to the WTO, and I just mentioned it because it's a way to respond to some of the people that think that that a pure multilateral approach is the only way to deal with this kind of issues. Subsidies is different from this kind of issue that we're looking at here in regulation, but it's about disciplines and rules, and it's very interesting that they were able to reach that kind of decision at a plurilateral level. So let me open the floor now and see if we have some participation from the public. We have about half an hour, I think. Yes, sort of. Okay. Yes, thank you, please. And just identify yourself.
Thank you. My name is Ariam from Indonesia. Thank you very much for all the presentation by the panelists. I think there is no doubt that there is some economic gain from regulatory cooperation. There is no denying that regulatory convergence is beneficial, but there is a concern, especially from developing countries, that it should remain voluntary. So the recommendations on making it an open plurilateral within the WTO is actually make sense instead of making it integrated in the multilateral framework within the WTO agreement. First of all, but this is actually what I want to take the discussion to, you know, at a broader level. I really want to see how the panelists, each of the panelists, could respond on the concerns, especially by developing countries, on regulatory convergence. First of all, that consequent, apart from the benefits from a regulatory convergence regime, there is also consequences that countries must face. First of all, it will reflect on the policy space of states in building capacity for local firms, establishing new industries and other industrial policies, diversification of new production base, and weaken the bargaining position of local firms vis-a-vis big multinational corporation in this GCC era. And we also see that this kind of effort has been done by the pharmaceutical industry within the World Health Assembly in 2014, and the World Health Assembly reject any reference to the ICH on the regulatory harmonization on pharmaceuticals, which is actually, you know, for developing countries, there is some national interest that we really don't want this kind of harmonization, you know, put forward by the ICH. So, and then including this, another issue would be including regulatory convergence within the framework of WTO instead of plurilateral would make it accessible to the WTO dispute settlement mechanism, which is actually right now having difficulties in, you know, in cases on regulatory measures. So how would each panelist would assess these consequences for developing countries if you really want to push this issue within the WTO framework? Thank you.
Well, thank you. Very good question. Wait, please.
Van Balantelis. My question is, because when you are talking about regulatory cooperation, it's mainly from a procedure aspect, mainly like transparency or like a conformity assessment. I think it's more from procedure perspective. What about from a substantive perspective, like the labor standards or like carbon maximum carbon ratio standards, because we have TRIPS agreement, which basically is addressing standards, intellectual property rights, which is the standards. They have setting for the minimum standards for IPR protection. Would the country, when they will talk about minimum standards for labor, labor standards, or maximum carbon ratio standards in response to the current Paris Agreement? Furthermore, and in parallel of the negotiation of environmental good agreements, because the environmental good agreements, as you mentioned, is mainly aimed to reduce the tariff. This is mainly benefit the existing industries, the strong, who have the strong import capacities. What about the newcomers, the new industries? They are yet to come to the market, and would we have an agreement to stimulate the investment in, for example, renewable energy? Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Anna.
Thank you, Anna Escobedo from ArcelorMittal. Maybe this is a bit more operational question. You were discussing about plurilateral versus bilateral and how to address this discrepancy on regulatory issues. My question is, if we look at the bilateral situation, sometimes you do have kind of dispute panels or agreements between the FTAs, but on the experience, we haven't seen any really active or positive discussion on quick solutions for this discrepancy. I think one of the proofs is on the negotiations on the TTIP between EU and the US. A big bunch of the challenge is to agree on homologation or mutual recognition. And sometimes these elements are taken out of the negotiation to facilitate. So on your experience, considering, okay, TBT, WTO solution, or putting a more pressure on bilateral solutions, how, for business like industry manufacturing, what would be the quickest way to address the discrepancy? Thank you.
Any other question that we have the time to respond to? Okay. So what I'd like to do is come back to the three are very good comments and questions. But I also want the panelists to talk to each other about what they have said, and that would be very interesting. So let me start sort of in the different order than before, and just take all the
difficult.
Okay, so Bernard, let's start with you, Bernard.
Okay, on the questions.
So both, if you can think about the questions, and if you have other points to make, that I think is the most efficient way to go about it.
Okay. Well, let me. So let me actually start with Alejandro's point and his examples, which I thought were very relevant and very important in terms of, you know, the traditional kind of debate, certainly in the economics literature. I mean, economists tend to be quite suspicious of regulators and regulation, right? So there's this whole Chicago school notion of regulatory capture. Essentially, regulators get captured by the industry they're supposed to regulate. I think that is pretty much disappeared as a notion. I think a lot has been done to actually address these types of issues, and I think right now we're confronting the opposite problem, really, that regulators actually find it much too difficult to interact with the sectors they're regulating, partly because they're having real strong firewalls put in place. So I think there is a balance to be struck there. But what struck me about Alejandro's comments is that it's not so much about regulatory capture per se, it's about, if I can put it the way I took it away, it's about political stupidity. It's regulators being confronted with populist pressures which they don't have enough to insure themselves against. So I think here, that's actually one response to my question, what's the role of a trade agreement, potentially, right? Because clearly if you can embed basic principles of good regulatory practice into trade agreements, that actually helps the regulators say, supported by the people in the trade ministry, hey guys, you know, you might think this is a wonderful idea, but it really conflicts with commitments we have signed up to in terms of what actually is good regulatory practice. That doesn't mean you can't regulate, but there are some disciplines that are put in place there. So I think that's an interesting and important example. On the question with respect to developing country concerns in terms of what is happening in this arena of regulatory convergence and cooperation, does it take away policy space? Does it limit the ability to use industrial policy and so forth? I would say no, in the sense that much of what we're talking about in this arena of regulatory cooperation is, to go to the second question, it's procedural, right? It's really about ensuring that you actually have a process that allows for input, not just from your domestic constituencies, but also a consideration of what are the implications of what you're going to do for the rest of the world. And I think the international standardization that there is a slow movement to achieve doesn't at all detract from a government's ability to actually support particular sectors or what have you. So I think in that sense, it's more an issue of creating certainty in terms of not being certain. So I think it's Alejandro's example again. You don't want to be in a situation where quite randomly you can be confronted with a new type of regulation, which really doesn't make a whole lot of sense, even from the industrial policy type of objective. So same thing with dispute settlements. So I think if we're really talking here about kind of embedding good regulatory practices, commitments to do certain things in a certain way, and if you don't do that, then I think the dispute settlement mechanism is actually something the trade kind of system can bring to the table, which regulators normally don't have, right? So again, it makes that commitment more credible, and it ensures the country against going down a regulatory track, which is really not in the country's longer term interest. So on the procedural versus substance, again, I think it's very, I would argue it's very much, we need to start with the procedural issues. I think certainly the last thing you want is to have kind of the trade community talk about the substance of regulation.
right? And that's the most rapid way I can conceive of regulators actually stomping on the brake immediately and saying, okay, we're out of here. So I think that needs to be done in the technical domains that Lorenza was talking about, where you actually have the sectoral regulators with industry participants, the people who actually do this, around the table to think about what actually makes sense for regulation. And in fact, that's how standards get set, right? That was not just abstract regulators sitting in a room saying, this is how we're going to regulate the industry. It is very much a cooperative process, because these regulations, for the most part, are really intended to help industry. So that's what the agenda is. So I would say these are different fora, and I think, so my answer to you would be on the procedural side is where we do this. I'll leave it at that. Thanks.
Lorenzo.
Thank you. Then I'll also start from Alejandro's comments about how do we ensure against bad policy. I think the most important way how regulators can ensure themselves against bad policy is really to have a model for their regulatory practice that they adhere to. And that's where international regulatory cooperation can help. And also ground these best practices domestically in an international process. And we've done extensive work in terms of also anchoring these processes on processes of risk management. So starting from what is the objectives that the government is trying to pursue through a regulatory instrument, and working through what is the best way of achieving that. And this really calls for the regulator not just to do what is referred to as RIAs, so regulatory impact assessment, but going before that. Like, regulatory impact assessment already imply that there is a regulation, and then, or at least a model for a regulatory for a technical regulation, and looking at its impact. We're suggesting to take a step back and think, what is your objective, and is regulation a good way of achieving that objective? So that is a way of ensuring you against bad policy, because it locks your regulatory practice into a system that is responding to concerns from the whole of society. I'd also like to touch upon Hoelim's reference to open plurilaterals. That was also the subject of one of the questions. And here, I think that what we see in these open plurilaterals is that they're most successful when they're standards receptive. So when they're receptive to international standards, when they are based on international standards, and not only to international standards, but also on international conformity assessment models and international conformity assessment practice. Because when that happens, the bilateral or the plurilateral will not be closed. It will be open to all those that are basing their regulatory practice on those standards, that are basing their conformity assessment on those principles, on those practices that we have available internationally. So I think this is the way to go. These open plurilaterals are definitely the way to go, and there is a lot of good examples in that area that we touch upon in our paper that is part of the E15 initiative. Briefly, the substantive concern, I think that having safe and compliant products on the market is the first step to guarantee that these concerns are met. Because unless you know that when you go out and buy a product which is energy efficient, for example, do you know that that's true? You know that that's true because there's tests and conformity assessment results that guarantee that that's true. Otherwise, you wouldn't be able to say that. So there's no one that can ensure those substantive concerns unless you've done this really procedural work, this detailed work. Finally, the quickest way, you were asking, from the industry, what is the quickest way about this? And I think it is using the market, using what exists in the market, having regulators be aware of and use system of conformity assessment that exist in the market and that can be referred to much more in domestic and international regulatory practice. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, hold on.
Thanks very much. Let me try to pick up maybe on a few points and also reflect on some things that have already been said. Maybe one which would be worth thinking a bit more about is the mention of dispute settlement. Okay, but I think a lot of what is being said is about really dispute prevention. You're trying to, hopefully, through regulatory cooperation and regulatory coherence, avoid the need for disputes. And actually, that's where a lot of the TBT experience has been quite interesting, because the TBT experience, through allowing greater transparency, through allowing comment on a regulation before it is adopted, through the sort of, attempt to move people towards international standards, are all means to try to avoid something becoming a dispute. And when there's a situation in which, there is still concerns about particular regulation, the practice of the TBT committee has been, to have specific trade concerns raised, and through that debate on specific trade concerns, hopefully resolve the issue, and before it gets into a dispute situation. And I think that's an important aspect to think about and to move further on, is this sort of third way between rulemaking and litigation. Currently in WTO, we don't do that terribly well in this middle path of deliberative functions, where we actually debate, or members debate, not us, I'm the secretariat, and to debate in a way in which they can actually resolve the problem. So TBT tries to do this, and imagine, currently there's about 460 specific trade concerns that have been raised in the TBT committee, and something like, there's been 5 cases and 1 ongoing. Now, if there was not this deliberative function, the WTO dispute settlement could not cope with 460 dispute settlement cases. So that's why I think a lot of these efforts are in this direction. A broader comment about, why should trade agreements get involved in this work? I think it's just unavoidable, because for what everyone has said so far, the traditional ways to dealing with trade barriers have, in a way, succeeded to more or less, not to on everything, but tariffs have come down significantly. So in a way, trade policy today is very much leading towards economic integration. Mm-hmm. And when you deal with economic integration, you have to deal with regulation. We cannot have clearly harmonized regulation, so we need to find different instruments to deal with this. And again, here, just to reflect what's already been said, that the easiest way in, nothing is easy, but clearly the easiest way in is to think about procedural aspects, the transparency, the ways in which conformity assessment procedures are undertaken, etc. And if you think about procedural aspects, comes back to my earlier point, it should be easy to make this MFN consistent, because you're not going to be transparent for one party and non-transparent for another. You would do it as a whole-scale reform, so to some sort.
Thank you, Halim. Let me just maybe rescue a couple of things here that I think are very interesting to just push forward further. So one is, that notion that the TVT committee serves as a as good offices that between and it stands sort of between rules and possible disputes. It's a very interesting one, and the evidence in the experience is very compelling in that respect. And that's something. It's a function that is probably lacking in other areas of trade and generally in trade agreements. So that's a point that I think is very interesting to pick up. Then the question of I go back to Alejandro and to some of the Bernard and so on. The question of why do trade agreements deal with this and what is it they're dealing with? Yes, so of course, yes, we're moving from the world where tariffs were used as protection to a world where regulations may be used as protection. But that's sort of a presumption as well on the nature of regulations or the motivation behind regulation. It is true, but they also respond to, again, other agendas, including very broad and high public policy agendas. And my sense is that what we're doing with trade agreements is regulating a space that has moved from even sort of a fragmented international markets into a global market, into what may be a global economy, then there is an obvious reason why you want to make sure that you deal with the heterogeneity in national regulations. But the key question is who calls then what is good policy, what's not good policy, what do you do with the differences in those societal preferences, I think is what, I don't have the accent that Alejandro has, but what someone had called him back when he was the commissioner in the EU. But so that's the thing. One thing is to try to handle through good regulatory cooperation practice the differences in product regulations and quality, being science-based when it comes to harm, for instance. But then the other one is to deal with the labor standards that you were talking about, no? Or say, for instance, this year, one of the most interesting decisions that has been taken at a higher level, if you like, it was the G7 decision to ensure that their companies follow sustainability principles in the supply chain, which has probably impacts in the whole global economy. What does it mean, and under which standards is this going to be pursued? And so those are questions that continue to be complex. We're entering into yet another complexity here that I borrow from another area where I'm very much I'm very interested in, which is climate change and environmental perspective. And so from the decisions that were made last week in Paris, the Paris Agreement, we entered a different world where once this become a treaty, you have a situation where national governments have decided in a bottom-up approach, their national determined contributions, which is their plans to address the question of climate change, are now part of that treaty. And so they would be able to take measures on the on climate action that are likely to be in conflict with again markets and with regulations and they are doing it under the aegis of an international treaty of universal character. And so how are we going to ensure that we have the consistency but also that we have the institutions? And the final point that I wanted to also rescue from what has been said and Holim made an emphasis there that is very interesting, is how regulatory reform is a public good, in a way, which is one of the issues that brings us back to the question of whether you need critical mass or not when you want to advance cooperation in the global space, right? So once you do it in the context of a plurilateral agreement within the WTO, or you do it in the context of a PTA or whatever, and you already engage in regulatory, in institutional reform back home, that's probably already going to be applied to everybody, whether they're party or not, to that regulatory cooperation. Rashmi, we have a few minutes. Okay, so I'll have to close in 4 minutes. But if there's anything from the audience or the panel, just please go ahead.
I just realized I forgot to respond a bit to the EGA question of tariff reduction. I think, you know, you have to see the EGA as the parties have called it, the living agreement. So their intention is to continually come back to this set of products that they're currently negotiating and to see how technologies evolve and what else could be added to it. So it is something that will continue, and clearly, you know, if there are new technologies coming to the market, they will have to look at it and to see how can this be brought to the table. So I don't think there's a problem here in this sense, you know. And the other thing to say is that the EGA, not concluded, but is going to be quite important to deal with some of the things that that Ricardo has said that has come out of the Paris Agreement, which is namely on the dissemination of green technologies. So this is one very concrete way which trade policy can interact with climate change policy. So that was it.
Yes, Lorenzo.
Yes, thank you. And I wanted to go back to the question from the floor regarding the policy space and the issue of having local expertise and local knowledge that has its space in this landscape. And I think that I wouldn't want for this panel to conclude that there is attention towards our regulatory harmonization internationally, because that wouldn't be true. It's true that each country is different, and it's true that each country has its own regulatory needs, and those needs need to be respected. And they are going to be respected to the extent that we are able to allow for differentiation within a safe and compliant world, so that there's no tension between the two in terms of having the same objective, really, and having this is also quite an important dimension in the sustainability agenda, I believe. Thank you.
Thank you, Lorenzo. Berta, any comments? Alejandro, comments? No. Okay, so just in closing, I think that is not only tame when it is a barrier, just in very simple terms, but also it is elevated, again, if it is something that is desired. Just put it in that way. And in both cases, there is a very important role through a very complex institutional system. But thank you all very much. We will continue work on this area, and we'll hope to continue to be engaged with all of you. Thanks all to thank you to all the panelists.